See the way he walks down the street. See the way he shuffles his feet. Why is he always the one to try the things they've never done? And just because of that, they say he's a rebel and he'll never ever be any good. He's a rebel cause he never does what he should. And just because he doesn't do what everybody else does, that's no reason why I can't share his love. He is always good to me, bad to me he'll never be. Cause he's not a rebel, no, no, no. He's not a rebel, no, 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 to me. Eat your heart out, darling love. Welcome, welcome. It's early morning on the West Coast. I know on the East Coast everything is going. You're probably watching this as you're getting home. So here's a little spark for you to refocus as you get home. I'm not a rebel. I'm a maverick. I see things differently than the Matrix tells me how I'm supposed to see it. I don't accept the rules, the laws of the Matrix, of this belief system, of this hypothetical scenario. I see freedom in a certain way, and I'm going with that, and I have a high degree of certitude that this is the way. And this morning, I discovered one last barrier to all of this big boost happening, etc., and that is awe. Now, in A Course in Miracles, it's always taught we should not be in awe of Jesus. Anandamayi said we should not be in awe of her. That's why she told everybody to view her as a sister, or as their little daughter, or as a sister or a friend, not as the mother. Because that, she says, that inculcates awe. And awe creates distance, and that creates a big, big problem. And I saw that it's a huge problem, really. Because what is there to be in awe of? If we actually consider this question, what is there to be in awe of? There's only truth. There's only one truth. And that is that reality doesn't have any problems. There's no need to solve any problems. So, for instance, Jesus, he's never solved any problems. Because he's realized there are no problems to solve. And that is true. We can realize the exact same thing. The Matrix is just this belief that there's a problem. Or there will be a problem, and that therefore we're supposed to solve it, that the problem will be real. It's not real yet, but it will be real. Therefore, we need to solve this problem. That is the Matrix. And the way out of the Matrix is to realize there is no problem. Therefore, we don't need to solve the problem. And that frees us from the Matrix. So, Jesus knows this one truth that we is always true, that we will know also, that we will accept. He simply accepted it. And that's all we have to do, too. So, if we think, well, what if Jesus or some whoever you view as a perfect embodiment of truth and certitude, what if you met them today? What would be your response? Now, most people would say, oh my gosh, I'd be in awe. And this morning, I asked that question of myself. It's sort of the question popped into my mind, like, hey, how do you think you would react? And I said, just shrugged my shoulders, said, well, certainly not awe. Why, in awe of what? It's not, never solved any, we're in awe of problem solvers, okay? And if we see Jesus as the ultimate problem solver, then we will be in awe. It's like, oh my gosh, how did you manage to solve these problems? That's absolutely incredible. It's absolutely, I can't even fathom it. So I'm so in awe because I can't fathom it. But if you see it, that Jesus didn't solve any problems, just real accepted the fact that there aren't any problems in reality, then what is the basis for awe? What is the basis? There isn't any basis. The way we overcome awe is there's no basis for it. There's no basis for it. We have been taught the notion that somehow the spiritual masters are mastering all these laws and they've been able to overcome enormous problems and crises and etc. Now, the true masters have accepted the fact, the truth, that reality doesn't have any problems. And this whole vast classroom of supposed learning situations where we learn to grow and expand our consciousness, etc., it's all totally hypothetical and completely under. They've accepted it. They didn't establish it as a fact. It's always been a fact. They simply accepted the fact, accepted the truth of this. And that's all we have to do as well. So my response was, no awe. I don't feel any awe at all. I couldn't find any basis for awe. Now, most people will say, that's completely heretical. What are you talking about? Oh, if I saw Jesus, I'd fall on my knees and, oh, Lord, Lord of the universe, and just be completely freaked out. Completely freaked out. Overwhelmed, etc. So, of course that's an obstacle. Who wants to be completely freaked out and overwhelmed? Of course that's an obstacle. Huge. For me, I wouldn't have any of those reactions. I can't find a basis for the reactions. Because I say, well, I'm on the same page as far as, I haven't accepted it yet, but I'm on the same page as seeing how simple it is. So it is so completely simple. What is the basis for awe? It's just simply accepting truth as true. That's all. And instead of trying to insist that truth isn't true, I just simply say, no, truth is true. What's so awesome about that? Why would I want anyone to be in awe of me? There's no basis for awe, actually. No basis for awe. And I'm sure that Jesus or Anandamayi Ramana Maharshi, they don't want us to be in awe of them. They would say, no. That's not an appropriate reaction at all. But if we don't see the situation, we will feel awe and then try to contain this and get all nervous and say, oh, I can't handle the situation. It's too much. It's overwhelming. No, I said, no. So maybe the big boost can come at some point here. Somebody has to go first, as it were. Someone has to connect up with the big boost, has to start that vibe, has to be willing to have that vibe. Now, you can't have awe. That interferes with the vibe of the boost. The vibe is just a smooth certitude, and calm certitude. Awe is like this, you know, trembling sort of overwhelming feeling that you're just your face is something you cannot comprehend. It's beyond your comprehension. No, it's not beyond our comprehension at all. And this is something, overcoming awe, something that is very crucial, that the teachers have worked very hard to bring this about. Now, Anandamayi Ma was such an extraordinary being in this world, having never, ever identified with this matrix at all. Never. It's not like that she identified with it previous lifetimes and got free of it. She said she had never, ever identified with it, ever. So that's so extraordinary. And so by having someone like that in the world, we get an opportunity to work on our awe problem and say, wow. And I've been doing that. That's what I've been doing. That's super helpful, super helpful. Conceptual teaching is very super helpful too, but also having someone in the world who is this so-called super, super, superstar, spiritual superstar, and you're able to work on overcoming your awe of that, not through dismissing them or putting them down or minimizing or anything like that, but just recognizing, hey, you know, she says awe is inappropriate. Stop, I don't want you to see me that way. That causes a problem. Try to work through this. And that's what I've been doing. And of course, people who see it differently, they may take exception to that and say, you know, you're too cavalier about it, or you're not having the appropriate respect of awe to the situation. And what can I say? It's for me, it's not appropriate, because it posits that the problems are real, and there's some way to then overcome these problems, and that someone has actually done that. That's not true. Nobody has overcome the problems of existence, because the problems of existence are unreal. How can you make what is unreal real and then overcome the problem? That's not possible. That makes a travesty of reality, a total travesty. So, just recognize today, don't have the awe. The awe is not there. Does that mean a lack of love, lack of respect? No, none of those things. None of those things. Just no awe. Because I'm looking at the same truth. I just have not accepted it purely, 100%, purely, completely yet, but I'm looking at the very same truth. Because that's where Jesus said to look. Said, look here. Look right here. And so I'm just looking right there and saying, yeah, okay, I see it. Very simple. The matrix is simply the belief that there's a problem in reality. And to get free of the matrix, we simply realize there is no problem in reality. That's it. It's that simple. So what is there to be in awe about? It is really that simple. But we come into this world I used to be able to see all these subtle forms and spiritual teachers, etc., with subtle vision, and I didn't have awe of them, and people in this world was like reacting like, what's the matter with you? You're some kind of crazy, egotistical maniac. How come you don't have awe? And I said, huh? Why? What? Why? And gradually, through all these different pressures, you know, succumbed into this syndrome. And people say, oh good, you have total awe of these beings. Oh, they're so awesome. But I said, there's something not right about that. So, here we go on this day. And actually, the end of probably end of your day on the East Coast, where many viewers actually are. There's some on the West Coast too, and maybe around the world. I don't know. Don't know where all the viewers are from, really. But we're behind times here on the West Coast. Everything happens ahead of time here. So we'll give this time to sink in, because it's incredibly crucial. Now, what I've found is that in teachings, the best path is to allow yourself to come in contact with teachings that seem a little bit over your head and like can't quite understand them, and it's a challenge. It's a real challenge. Like when I first became aware of Ananda Mahima, it was a super challenge for me. Super. I said, wow, this is an incredible challenge. How do I fit this in with my viewpoints? And yeah, it's doesn't seem to fit. This is an amazing challenge. Same with the Course in Miracles, an extreme challenge. But that's the way to do it. You by doing that and picking up the challenge, you will gradually get yourself up to speed. Whereas if you don't pick up any challenge and you just go along with, you know, the dogma of the matrix, you won't get up to speed. You might feel it's easier because you're not running uphill, but how are you going to get on top of the mountain if you don't go uphill, so to speak? And it's an uphill climb to get free of the matrix, because everyone here believes that the problems are real, that best this is a classroom, that somehow God created this classroom for us to learn how to be good, learn how to be loving, learn all this kind of stuff. And so we just assume that this is true. And then we say, wow, how do this seems overwhelming. It's going to take a long time, a lot of effort. And the idea that we're supposed to finish right now seems, oh, that's going to be too difficult. As if we see, it's a vast, vast learning curve, incredible learning curve here. Then when someone tells us, yeah, we have to do it all, you know, this lifetime, get finished, it seems like, well, that would be too difficult, too much study, too much effort. It's going to just be crushingly difficult. That's not true. Because what we realize as we go along is how simple it actually is, that this whole scenario here, which is really a spiritual hallucination projected into an imaginary place called the future, that's also a hallucination, where we are trying to solve a problem that we imagine is going to take place in reality at some point in reality. And the fact is, we simply see, but gradually we recognize that reality will never have any problems. It's impossible that reality has any problems. Therefore, this hypothetical problem will never take place. So why do we need to try to learn to adapt to it? Why do we need all these lessons? We do not. We simply need to accept the fact that of reality as it is. Accept reality as it is. That is all we need to do. And that is the escape from the matrix. That's it. There isn't any other escape. Either we accept reality as it is, or we find ourselves in the matrix battling ETs and malevolent forces. and the dream presents itself in a very confusing, malevolent form. And no matter what we do, it continues to be weird and confusing. And the so-called spiritual masters of this matrix, they're always complaining, subtly complaining, that God threw them a curveball. They said, we thought we had it all figured out, and our plans were all set up. And then suddenly something totally unexpected came in. They said, wow, God is so mysterious. The depths of God's mystery is unending. We're never going to get to the bottom of it. But we keep trying. And we've solved a lot of it. But out of the blues, this situation arose we didn't expect. They're always saying that. The ETs are saying that. The spiritual masters are saying that, etc., some of them. The ET-based spiritual masters are always complaining about, they have everything set up, and they say, we're going to help you, save you, blah, 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 and then, something happened. Terrible. Wow, how come we didn't see this? Well, God is so mysterious. That's the matrix that's mysterious, because it's constantly generating crises. That's its purpose. It comes from mind. Mind is just imagining this whole thing, and so it can imagine any crisis at all. It can come out of the blue. A new crisis will arise. I've never seen this crisis before. Where did it come from? That's exactly what the matrix is. This hypothetical scenario that the younger generation calls the matrix. That's what it is. It constantly generates crises and challenges for us to supposedly learn from and overcome, because what it's modeling is annihilation. That's what existence is, actually symbolizing annihilation and parsing it out bit by bit by bit, so we can somehow learn to adapt to annihilation. And how do we do that? By pretending to be the annihilators. In other words, wielding the power of annihilation. So we must be prior to annihilation, therefore we must be able to survive it. And therefore you have all these wars, conflicts, destructivity, and of course people within the matrix are all saying, we gotta find peace, we gotta pray for peace, we gotta meditate for peace, we have to find a way to peace within the matrix. That's impossible. It is impossible. Totally impossible. You cannot change the purpose of an idea. You cannot change the effects of an idea, change the purpose that they serve. That is impossible. So simply recognize that there isn't any problem in reality, and there never will be a problem in reality. That's the recognition that Jesus has, and Ramana Maharshi, they all have that recognition that there is no problem in reality, and there never will be. Simple acceptance. You're just accepting truth as true. That is all you're doing. And so what is there? Why be in awe of accepting truth as true? That can be done at any time by anyone. There's no technique to it at all. It's just a recognition and acceptance. Truth is true, always will be true. And then turn this dream over to God, the grace of God. Let the grace of God overlay this dream and let it wind down in a way that's acceptable to you. Because God is very aware that we have affection for our imagination, what we have imagined. So God's not going to attack it. God will wind it down in a way that is totally acceptable to us. We'll make it seem completely beautiful to us. Overlay it with this unconditional love. So we don't have to worry about solving these problems, etc. Instead of solving the problems, God just overlays the whole thing. Permanent overlay. And then our attention gets transferred over to the beauty of the overlay instead of the energy form. A dance of the matrix, and we accept that. We say, that's acceptable to us. Okay, we didn't want to just disappear, because we have affection and we've been imagining this for so long. We just didn't want to disappear. We don't want the universe to disappear. No, it's overlaid. It's overlaid. It's still there, but it's for instance, the deposits of amber from trees, that the insects are trapped in this amber, and they've got this beautiful amber. There's an insect in there. You can look at the amber and say, oh my gosh, look how beautiful that amber is. And you don't even need to look at the insect. Well, we might look and say, that's not important. Look how beautiful the amber is. Well, that's an analogy, but the overlay of all of the matrix, all of this hypothetical scenario of existence is so beautiful, so exquisitely beautiful and peaceful, and seamless, etc., that our attention goes there, and we can notice these little shadows form, etc., that are being overlaid, but our attention goes to what is truly beautiful and exquisite. We say, look at this overlay, how exquisite. And yet, it's still what we've imagined and had affection for so long. It's still there. Our attention is no longer drawn to it. No longer drawn to it. That's the way. Simple way. And we need to keep carrying this over and over and over until it gradually sinks in. That's the only way to go about it, is to let it sink in. Gradually, you have to keep listening. You may think you're not making any progress. That's not true, because the answer is so simple that you can't even use the term progress to describe it. But however, there is this sinking in. You're gravitating towards it as you hear it over and over. I must have heard this, hundreds of thousands of times in different formats and gone over and over and over and over and over. Gradually, you get to the level of acceptance. The whole thing is acceptance. That's all there is to it, is simply accepting truth is true. Truth as true. It doesn't need to be worked on. It doesn't need to be improved. It doesn't need to be fixed up. It's not damaged. It's not injured. Just accept it as it is without right now, meaning we don't have to do anything to it. And so it's not a learning. The freedom from the matrix is not a question of learning so much as acceptance. And acceptance is something that kind of can be practiced, something you need to practice all the time, every day, is just trying to accept this, accept truth as true, accept reality as it is. Continue to work on that. The different paths. The path of Yani is clarification. The path of Bhakti is like a path of love. That Bhakti path is simply you practice accepting everything as it is. In other words, having love for everything as it is, not judging, putting a feeling of acceptance first. We call it love, but it's actually acceptance. At the level of all this impermanence and this hypothetical scenario, it's more an issue of acceptance. You can call it love if you want, or the heart, or whatever, but it's simply put acceptance first in your life. That's the Bhakti path. Accept everything as it is. That's easily translatable into the overlay. So the Bhakti path is great. It works. It works for some people who have that predisposition, the path of the heart. In other words, accept. The Yani path works very well too. Someone who is very good at working with concepts and clarifying the overall theory and structure and seeing it at that level, that also works. It just depends what your path is. Also, the path of service also works, where the path of non-attachment is path of service, is the path of non-attachment, where you practice accepting the fact that none of this is real. They'll all be overlaid, and you're not expecting any results from your actions, meaning you're not trying to solve any problems here. You're just selflessly serving, not being worried about any results, meaning not trying to fix or solve anything ultimately. That too is easily translatable into the overlay, into accepting reality as it is. So those main paths and other, all variations of them, are all the same. They have the same goal, accept reality as it is. This is all classical teaching. This is the way it's been. This is the way it's always going to be. There's nothing new under the sun as far as truth being true and accepting reality as it is. That will always be exactly what needs to be done. Doesn't matter what cycles there are in existence, and we're headed into a new cycle. Very soon, that situation is getting turnkey ready, and what is going to happen December 21st, I don't know. I mean, around that time frame. But there's going to be some precipitating events that crystallize the consciousness of the planet in a certain direction. Maybe contact with ETs, possible. There may be some announcement, you know, at some point, the announcement that we have been contacted by extraterrestrials. Some government might announce it or whatever. Of course, this has been going on and on and on already. It's just that, you know, mass consciousness has not yet been plugged into this so much. But they've been prepared. So when that comes, people's consciousness is going to shift, and they're going to think, here are our saviors. The ETs are our saviors, and they're gonna go with that. And at that point, they're really going to get off track, severely off track. Because the ETs are very off track. I know, because I've been dealing with them for a long time, and they're very off track, really, severely off track. It never occurs to them that this is all a hypothetical dream scenario and we can simply accept reality as it is. It just doesn't occur to them at all. They're hell-bent on trying to solve problems. What they're about is solving problems faster, more efficiently. That's what they're about. So, of course, this new cycle will be all about how to more efficiently and rapidly work on solving problems. And that's no fun at all. Yeah, there's no grace. There's no love. There's no true depth to that. There's no bliss to that. No bliss to that, really. There's no joy to it. It's very joyless. it's all kind of a Third Reichish, you know, it really is. We're going into sort of a global Third Reich of just this, you know, sort of glorying in super efficiency. Everything being monitored so we can all be more efficient. Everything, our whole lives, all being called for data and how can we, and getting feedback, like how can we become even more efficient machines to solve this vast cosmic mystery, that problem that we just can't yet crack. But if everybody gets in the chain gang, that somehow we'll be able to crack this big problem. It's already been cracked, and it's cracked by saying there is no problem. And the ETs cannot wrap their heads or minds around that. They just cannot. They have a severe problem with that. I've been trying to help them, but no, they're tough nuts to crack, I'll tell you that. Actually, us so-called quote-unquote humans are way more advanced than the ETs in a lot of ways, way more advanced. And because we at least here on this planet, have gravitated towards accepting reality as it is. We have a tremendous tradition here of wisdom teaching, of ambassadors of certitude coming into this world and enlightening us on this fact. So the way I look at it is humans are more advanced than ETs, way more advanced. They're actually very regressed. And they're just sophisticated savages, really. That's how I look at them. Sophisticated savages, and what they're doing is they're turning in the whole world into a place of sophisticated savagery, and because that's what they are. That's what they are. They very, very unaware of how to be free of the matrix. They simply have focused on manipulating the matrix, of trying to be clever within the so-called rules and laws of the matrix, which are simply rules and laws, imaginary rules and laws of imaginary situation, of a hypothetical situation that we're just hallucinating, meaning spirit, mind is hallucinating it to present this to spirit. So we don't have to bow in awe to the ETs. I'm not in awe of them at all. I don't bow to them, not in awe in the slightest bit. They're regressives. They're regressives. They need to sit quietly and listen. Humans are not inferior. Not inferior at all, but we've been taught to see the ETs are so insecure about their position that they want to teach everyone before they come into a world. They want to teach everyone to submit to them and view them as superior. And so they've done this brainwashing job, propaganda job on this planet that is severe, so that most people will view them as their superiors, which is what they've really done, is they've dumbed the world down. Last 50 plus years have been a time of dumbing the world down. And those who realized this was happening, they said, I don't want to be dumbed down. I better really get with this. Unfortunately, we had some fabulous teachers here, fabulous teachers, and some fabulous curriculum and teaching. And if we got with that, we're not intimidated by the ETs. And we didn't get dumbed down. We got smartened up so, tremendously. So we're not going to submit to the ETs. We're going to tell the ETs to sit down and shut up and listen, because they should be here to listen to truth. Instead, they're coming here to rule the world, which is a joke, which is a joke. They should be in satsang. They should come to satsang. So maybe I'll set up a satsang. Maybe satsang will be set up, and then we'll invite everybody, including the ETs, and say, come here to satsang and sit down and shut up and stop your stupid mind control techniques and all this subtle etheric manipulation, et cetera, et cetera. That's not the way. That's not the way. But they cannot help functioning in the way that they're accustomed to functioning. And they want the world to kowtow to them and place them as the rulers and their proxies, the satraps, the sycophants here. They want them to be the rulers, to rule over humanity. In order to do that, they had to dumb down humanity, and humanity is very dumbed down now, extraordinarily dumbed down compared to what it used to be. People used to have what's called common sense, and nowadays what we've been taught is like common sense is like stupidity, and that we're supposed to not trust that, and we're supposed to go into the stupid mode, which is what's called celebrity mode. We have a celebrity culture on this planet. That is by design. The ETs have all designed that celebrity culture. The whole Hollywood thing, celebrity culture, is all comes from the ETs, who want to train the world to worship at the feet of so-called celebrities. And the ETs will be seen as celebrities. They want to be seen as celebrities here. And the world has gotten accustomed to that. For me, I detest celebrities. And I don't hate them, but I detest the whole celebrity culture thing. It is just a joke. It is a joke. Celebrities should sit down and shut up, go to satsang, and hear the truth. And just pay attention to that and go on the path to salvation, which is to accept reality as it is. Stop parading around it is just pathetic. Just pathetic. Those people, the celebrities we get in the world, they're just pathetic. Really pathetic. But the ETs are training the world to fixate on celebrities, and then the ETs will be seen as these super celebrities, and the world will fixate on them and kowtow to them and watch their every move. You know, wow. They'll be on Twitter and they'll have half the world will be following them on Twitter, everything they do. Now, I'm trying to counter this by a big boost to say, well, maybe we should have divine distraction here and follow that. Those who are used to following someone, maybe they'll follow someone who is an actual quote-unquote superstar, but is really just a very humble servant of the truth. But I don't know how that will go, but it's a possibility. Because the problem is that we have been acculturated now to celebrity culture, or we've got a sort of reaction formation to that where we reject following anything. But that's more of a reaction. I don't know how it's going to go exactly. I really don't. It's an interesting conundrum, isn't it? how to help the world is an interesting conundrum. But it's either one way or the other, so it's not a problem. Whatever works, works. Because the problem is, if you get into a negative situation where you're just hating on the ETs and trying to tear them down, that's not good for you either. That creates a confrontational situation, which is very harmful to you. It's not good. So it's just saying no, 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 no. What you need is something to say yes, 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 yes to. And if the world gets caught up in a celebrity culture, which it will, that's this new cycle is going to cycle itself in, probably through this means of a super celebrity culture, and people kowtowing to the ETs and just being giddy about it. There may be a need for divine distraction at that time, so that you can slingshot that boomerang, this as it were, into a positive for you, where you put your attention on those who have accepted reality as it is, and gradually you then that way overcome the awe of the ETs, which certainly that will be percolating on the planet to a very extreme extent. So there may need to be an overlap here of hanging out with spiritual superstars, those who've accepted reality as it is, hanging out with them, following what they're doing. And then gradually, by doing that, you will, one day you'll look at the ETs and the whole world and this whole cycle, just look at it and say, poof, what is this? I'm not going to kowtow to this. That's ridiculous. I'm not going to follow this. That's ludicrous. And then you get a sense like, oh, this path is not, I'm not in awe of it, of truth. I'm not in awe of truth. So I can accept this. So there might be this kind of overlapping situation that needs to account for what's going to happen in the world. I expect this as a possibility. I've prepared for this as a possibility, that this could be necessary, that there be a time of divine distraction to counter the moves of the ETs into this world. As that most certainly is going to happen, the ETs have absolutely planned this down to an extraordinary extent. The only thing they don't know how to deal with is divine distraction here. They don't understand it. They don't know how to deal with it. They'll just ignore it, is what they'll do. They'll just ignore it, which is fine. I don't have any hatred for the ETs at all. They're one with reality, too. We're all one. And it's just that the have not yet seen the truth that this is all hypothetical and there is no problem in reality. Now this planet hasn't quite seen it yet, but we've done work to overcome our awe of this. We have done work. This, the human civilization over the last thousands of years has done a lot of work in this direction. And we're still a little confused about it. But a lot of us are not so confused to be in awe of the ETs, whereas those who have been dumbed down are like, they're just waiting. They're watching the television like, when are the ETs going to show up on television? When are the ETs going to show up? Oh, they're going to call themselves the saviors. Oh, okay. We'll go with that. So they're all waiting for the advent of the ETs, really. That's what the globe is waiting for. And those who claim that they're going to usher in this advent, oh boy, everybody's bowing to them too. Oh, we can't wait. We can't wait for the ETs to arrive and share their knowledge with us, is the way they put it. Share how to make a global culture of peace, all this kind of stuff. And we don't realize what it's really about is completely delusional, and we're just headed into like work camps, so to speak. The whole doggone world will be structured in a terrible way compared to what it has been, actually terrible. And what is lost out on that is all the focus on truth, the focus on accepting reality as it is, the focus on those ambassadors of certitude. We'll forget all about them. We'll deny all of that in our rush to emulate these ETs, submit, want to ape them, as it were. They'll say, well, you need to get rid of all your foolish fantasies about these spiritual, great spiritual saviors, etc. They say, that's not the way. They'll say that the way is to knowledge. You need to study more. You need to understand energy more, and blah, blah, blah. And that's what will happen. That's what will happen. So really, for me, it's like a race against time before these ETs really show up here in this world, as they will do. They have a plan to do this. Is a race against that, because most people's heads are going to be turned. And how do you help those who don't really want to have their heads turned? How do you help them not go into some reaction formation of just pulling the blanket over their head and going into bed into a fetal position? That's not it either. That's not it either. You have to acknowledge, hey, okay, this is what's happening. Fine. And it doesn't change anything about the truth. And I'm not battling against it or anything, just ignoring it or just dismissing it. Not ignoring it as a reaction, the formation of fear, but just simply acknowledge it and say, well, it's nothing to be concerned about in the slightest bit. Nothing to focus on at all. No trouble there either. There's no trouble. There's no problem to be solved, including this new world order. That's also not a problem to be solved. And it's just this complete high indifference. It's a high indifference. It's not born of fear. It's born of clarity and accept, willingness to accept reality as it is. That high indifference is what is needed. Now, I don't have enough at this point. I'm not at the point of radiating this to the extent that it could turn people's heads back away from the ETs or from a reaction formation to this situation. But what I'm hoping is that there will be those in the world who are at this able to do this, or maybe I'll be able to at some point in the near future. I don't know. I try not to focus on my own past, try to project it in the future. That causes problems. I just try to stay within the moment where I'm at right now. And it's possible, of course. I know anything's possible, as far as you never know when you can suddenly accept reality as it is, tip the scales, and then accept the overlay. And at that point, one would radiate the assurance and be a so-called spiritual superstar as far as the planet is concerned. And then, of course, you have to be able to handle the awe factor and say, no, is it not appropriate, without dumbing yourself down. Now, what I did in this world is I saw that people were prone to awe of spiritual ambassadors of certitude. And I saw that's not appropriate at all. And so what I did was I dumbed myself down so people wouldn't have any awe. But that's a stupid thing to do. It's not the right thing to do. It's kind of the wrong way to try and go about mitigating the awe, is to say, well, there's nothing to be in awe of because I'm just like you. I'm ignorant, just like everyone else. So why be in awe? Well, it took care of the awe problem for sure, but it also resulted in just being completely ignored, which isn't helpful at all either. So there has to be a better way than that. Has to be a better way than that. So I'm trying to drop that wrong approach to the situation and get back to the overlay, get back to radiating certitude. And at the same time, you have to find those who are not really in awe or don't have a reaction formation, or at least able to hang out with that, hang out with that. There must be some in the world that, I don't know where, but there must be some that can hang out with that. And oftentimes people simply need to be quiet, and because they're making a supreme effort not to be stampeded into awe or reaction formation against the awe, like, well, I hate this person's nothing, this is nothing, nothing here, this is terrible, which is, they know that's not true either. So it's not easy, it is not easy, because our assumptions are wrong. So oftentimes people just sit quiet, they try to just check out and say, well, everything's okay. That is really like the highest kind of satsang. The highest kind of satsang is to just to sit quietly like that and check out and not panic, not go into awe and not go into flight. Those two reactions. There's two reactions. One is to flee. One is to flee and saying, oh, this situation here is completely insane. The other is to jump into an awe and say, this situation is totally awesome. Neither one of those is right. So the ones who can simply, oftentimes you just simply have to sit there quietly, and your psyche is reverberating like a bell's ringing, and you just sit there quietly and just let it ring. So I don't need to do anything about it. Let me just sit here quietly. That is really the highest satsang. I wish all of us could get into that type of satsang. Because gradually, as you get used to this bell ringing, then you really make progress. It's super fast progress, as far as you don't flee and you don't jump into awe. And then you get closer to saying, oh, all I have to do is accept reality as it is, and I'm exactly the same as they are. See, I don't have any awe for Jesus or Nanda Mayamara Maharshi, because I know I can be exactly the same as they are simply by accepting reality as it is, which is all they did. That's all they've done. It's all that they've done. They haven't done anything other than that. Accept reality as it is. And reality already is as it is. Truth is already true. It's not something to be established. It's already true. So they haven't done anything extraordinary at all. Not at all. And we are not called to do anything extraordinary. Just something totally simple, totally basic, totally obvious, totally easy. What they've done is completely easy. Seen from the right perspective. So how to deal with the issue of flight or awe, it's the issue that's holding things up. And Anna Mai Ma was super great at that, super great. She was just like a genius, complete genius at it. And that's the thing that kind of boggles my mind. It's like, wow, how could anyone be so adroit at dealing with the situation? She's constantly making adjustments and making it easy and people to be comfortable and finding it's just amazing. it's hard to fathom how anyone could function that way. Continuous stream of, from a miraculous way of functioning to circumvent this problem of awe. But even then, she would say, everybody still has this problem very severely, and they all want to build a temple to me and put a shrine and call me mother and bow to me and divine mother. She says, that's getting in the way, and I saw that. But most people, they haven't seen that about her. When she says that's getting in the way, you've got to just see me as your friend or your sister or as your little daughter. Don't see me as a mother. Come on, this is getting in the way. Awe gets in the way. She's so right about that. Awe gets in the way, and yet she never dumbed herself down at all. That's why I see that as a great role model, because she didn't dumb herself down to try and dampen down people's awe. She said, because she knew, no, that's not the way. We have to get over our awe. And how can we do that except to be challenged to do it? If we dumb ourselves down, like I did, how does that help anybody? The people say, no, there's no challenge there at all. They say, he's just some knucklehead like everybody else. There's no challenge. The challenge, you have to take up the challenge. You have to have someone there where you're tempted to awe, and then work on that and see how you can finally work through it without trying to tear them down or attack them or flee. You can't attack them really, so you would flee without fleeing away, without jumping into awe, that kind of thing. So there is a way. There is a way. She showed the way. There is a way to do it. So I have that lineage of that, of knowing that there is a way to do it. And it's probably a work in progress. I mean, she was just a complete, total genius at it. And I don't expect to be that, or I don't expect you to be that. I don't expect anybody to be like that. But I do expect that we can tackle this situation somehow. It can be the challenge can be taken up. How do you deal with that which is accepted reality as it is here in this world? How is that? How can we deal with that without fleeing or jumping into awe? And there are ways. She integrated everybody's lives in just a natural kind of way, and so that's pretty amazing. In just a sort of a social way, a natural way, it's just quite amazing, but not awesome. No, I can see how it's possible. Sure. It's just you have to have this perfect seam to do it like that. You really cannot miss a step. You cannot miss a beat at all. You have to play it perfect. But I don't believe that we need to be perfect at this at all. No, we do not. It's not like that. It is sufficient to hang out with certitude and not think that we have to be flawless at it, or the certitude has to be flawless. And it's not true. It's not the case. It's just that we have to accept, so deep down we have to accept it. We can do it. It is possible. We can do it, and we need to do it, because again, this celebrity culture of the ETs is coming. It could come any day. It could come today. I mean, the Vatican has already gotten many ready for it by constantly releasing all these things about extraterrestrials, saying, "Well, what if we extraterrestrials we were contact by them? How would we relate to that?" They're even putting out in, I think, some papal statement. What do they call it? Papal bull or something, or I don't know exactly how they call it. The word escapes me, but they're putting out releases through various cardinals, through various bureaucratic agencies of the church, talking about how Catholics should respond in case we are contacted by extraterrestrials. They know what's going on, believe me. That the Vatican is connected. Okay. And they know what's going on. When they start putting out encyclicals or something that talk about how should we respond if the world happens to be contacted by extraterrestrials, you've got to say, hey, why would they do that if it's not going to be happening? No, they're preparing their flock for that very eventuality. They must know it's coming. They must know it's coming. And I would say for sure it's coming. And but see, most people have been trained not to see them as extraterrestrials, but as superstar celebrities. They're not going to relate to it as ETs. They're being taught not to. Like, oh no, these are our brothers, space brothers. But even gloss it over even more than that. Like this is they'll kind of see them just as celebrities. and just kind of fall down at their feet, and maybe like spiritual masters. They'll see them as spiritual masters, or some type of externalization of spiritual hierarchy here to save humanity. And they won't view them as extraterrestrials, really. That'll be seen as insulting. Now, we have this whole culture of what's called tolerance that is supposedly was really getting us ready for the advent, the so-called advent of the ETs here, the arrival of the ETs coming out of the closet. This whole coming out of the closet thing is really designed for the ETs to come out of the closet. It's getting us ready to be tolerant of behavior and culture which is repugnant to us, like we're saying, like, yuck, we don't want this, we don't like this. So we have been programmed now to accept a cultural shift that we may find repugnant and we don't want it, but to feel that we're somehow bigoted if we don't accept it. So all this stuff is a lead up. People talk about, there have been a lot of people trying to figure out what in the world is the gay agenda about, because it seems like it's about more than just human rights. There's another layer to it. If just about human rights, fine, that it's not a problem. But it seems to be there is some deeper layer, like this kind of urgency to what is it? Well, I can tell you what it is. It is actually getting the world ready for the ETs to come out of the closet here. And so the thing is, we have this disgust for ETs. We don't like what they, really don't want to deal with them, because we have recognized for thousands of years that they don't have the answer. They're actually regressive, very sophisticated savages. And what it is, we're being kind of trained how to embrace something we really don't want to embrace, because whatever you want to say about gay people themselves, which I don't have any hatred towards and accept them just as I accept anyone else, but the culture, the gay culture, is something that most people find quite distasteful, actually. And we are basically being taught that we're bigoted if we find that the gay culture is not our cup of tea. It's not our cup of tea. Most people say, no, that's not our cup of tea. And we're being told that when we see something that is not our cup of tea at all, that somehow we're extremely bigoted, extremely intolerant, extremely ignorant. So when these ETs come out and we all say, oh my gosh, this is not our cup of tea at all, we've already been trained to feel guilty about that. So, kowtow to them. Oh gosh, I don't want to be a bad person. I don't want to be guilty of bigotry and all this, call it what, celebrophobic. I don't want to be celebrophobic. And people say, well, you're homophobic. Well, celebrophobic. We don't want to be celebrophobic. These are super celebrities, and we're being celebrophobic. So we have been trained in this way to get ready for the ETs. So I've seen all of this stuff happening. It's like, wow. Just thinking and observing it, because they literally used all this stuff as their agenda, as their way to smooth the way, to pave the way for them to come out of their closet, come out of the ET closet. And of course, we're supposed to now embrace anyone who comes out of the closet. We're supposed to embrace them and put them on a pedestal. Put them on a pedestal, like they're somehow superior. They're somehow superior. As part of the gay agenda is to view the gays as superior, actually. That they have some kind of higher love, higher something even better than just the rest of the people are just breeders or something. These are higher, something higher, which is nonsense. It's nonsense. And just like the ETs are not higher. And many people feel that the gay lifestyle and the gay culture is not something higher, that it, and in some cases it might be something actually regressive. So the ETs are actually regressive, but they want us to see them as higher. So they're kind of using the whole gay agenda thing as actually has an underlying purpose to it. And I know a lot of people have felt that there's something afoot here that is not being talked about. But it's time to bring that out of the closet, right? Bring the hidden agenda out of the closet. And it's simply getting the world ready for the extraterrestrials to come out of their closet here. To then embrace them and put them on a pedestal and say that they're better than us. And that our reactions, negative reactions to them, are reflections of our inferiority, which is not true. It is not true. We have had Jesus Christ here in this world. We've had Ananda Mahima. We've had Gautama Buddha. We've had Ramana Maharshi. And we've had myriads of other great ambassadors of servitude here in this world, helping us towards recognizing and accepting reality as it is, and seeing that this whole thing is a hypothetical scenario. So how is it that we are inferior to those who have no knowledge of this stuff, who are in a very dark condition of trying to manipulate the matrix? How are we inferior? We're not inferior. It's the ET culture that has degraded. It's not the human culture. And they've tried to convince us that somehow the human culture of spiritual effort is somehow inferior to theirs and degraded, which is completely upside down and backwards, actually. But what they want to do is they've trained us to embrace something that is actually retrogressive, regressive, as if it were superior. As if it were superior. And there's no way that gay culture is somehow superior to heterosexual culture. It's in the way I see it, and the way actually a lot of gays will tell you honestly, the honest ones will say, it's not cool at all. It's not good. It's regressive, actually. They don't even like it. And yet we're supposed to lionize it and say, you know, oh yeah, this is actually a superior culture. It is not. And the ETs are not a superior to humans. They're regressive. Most of them, the ones that are here to be the celebrities in this world, it's regressive. They're sophisticated savages. There's no reason to kowtow to them, and you just put them in context. They're ignorant. Put them in context. They're very ignorant, and therefore they need to go to satsang. And if they don't go, you should go, because if you don't go, they will ban satsang. Because it's an affront to their so-called dignity and position. The fact that there's something that they should be doing that they're not doing, the way they deal with it, instead of acknowledging it honestly, they just deny that, say, oh, no, let's ban satsang, and then there's nothing I need to be doing that I'm not doing. It's a crazy, upside-down, backwards way of trying to elevate themselves by simply denying that they need to, there's something they need to realize that they are unwilling to realize. They don't want to admit their ignorance. And so they just say, well, let's ban any situation that's designed to help us come out of our ignorance. They're not being honest. The first step in salvation is to be honest and say, admit we're miserable. We're miserable. We're ignorant. There's something we're missing. That's the first step. They call it repentance. And if you're alcoholic, a drug addict, etc., the first step is to realize, admit, I've got a problem. I'm miserable. I am miserable. And that's the first step. The idea, you know, Christianity said we're all sinners, meaning we're all miserable. We're all missing the mark. There's something we're missing. That is true. So that's the first step. And then to try to figure out what is it we're missing? Why are we miserable? Is to look into it. Not be prating around as a celebrity, like we're here to fix all the problems of the world and we're supposed to bow to us. That's not what they should be doing. They should be admitting we're miserable, we're missing something, we need to be enlightened, we need to attend satsang, inquiry, contemplation, clarity, attend clarification. That's true re-education. It's not re-education, it's clarification. And that's what they should be doing. That's what they should be doing. But they don't want to. Because they think they can lord it over us and convince us they're superior to us, which is a delusion. They're not superior. And yet they have brought out all these very clever agendas of the world being taught to place above themselves that which is actually not above them, which is actually regressive stuff, lesser stuff. They're being taught that we're supposed to erase that as superior. And feminism is part of that too, partially. The distorted feminism, the original feminism, which I supported and still support, is that all women should have access to clarification, and because they can accept reality as it is, exactly the same as all men can. There's no difference whatsoever. They can accept it just the same, and so I completely support that. What I don't support is the notion that somehow females are superior to men. which is what feminism really is about, is not about equality, it's about superiority and dominance. And that's the distorted, usurped feminism, that the ETs usurped it and are using it for their own agenda, again, to convince us to accept them as superior to humanity. Same kind of thing. So, all of these agendas over the last 50 years have been designed to get people to accept what is not, accept delusion as somehow, they're in a state of darkness, greater darkness than humanity, and we're supposed to accept them as superior. And so whatever in this world that has been lagging behind, as it were, it's been twisted into seeming that it's superior. Now, the truth is that females on this planet had been lagging behind because they were excluded from clarification, consideration to some extent. Not entirely, but to some extent. That is very true, which is something I abhor. And I said, no, that equal access to clarification should be the case. And there are also people on this planet who are lagged behind, because, and they're very much bound into superstition and myth and fear and all the stuff there are. And that's not good either. But it's a fact. But to take people that are actually lagging behind, regressive, and to now lionize them and put them on top as somehow they're superior, all that's being done by the ETs to get us to accept them as superior to us. And they say if we don't do that, we're racist, we're sexist, and we're homophobic, and all this kind of stuff, all these name-callings, all coming from the extraterrestrials. The truth of the matter is, prior to the ETs coming here and getting ready to take over this planet, the world had much better common sense, and people recognize that some people have spent more time in spiritual clarification than others, and that's no judgment on anyone else at all. It is simply a fact, and that needs to be recognized, and they are here to share that and help others, and there's no judgment at all on that, and people understood that. They understood. So, and what's the big deal? But ET's completely twisted that all up into saying that somehow those who have gone further towards clarification are exploiting the others and holding them down, and that the way that this needs to be twisted and flip-flopped, and the ones that have been exploited need to be raised up to now rule over the others, etc. That's all serving the purpose of the ETs. It doesn't serve the purpose of the humans at all. It's an ill-suited purpose completely, because it doesn't solve the problem at all. It makes it worse. It makes it worse. And so we have been under this all-out assault, especially like white men have been under incredible assault, because the culture of the Judeo-Christian culture, as it were, and other cultures around the world, the Buddhist culture, etc., Islamic culture, etc., the men did have a lot of access to clarification, and they did spend a lot of time on that, and they have made a lot of clarification has happened, and that's just the way it is. And they're trying to help the world and saying, look, there is a path to salvation. That doesn't make them evil, doesn't make them racist or homophobic or any of that stuff. That's not the purpose of it at all. It's simply to share the love of truth that they have managed to get, some of that love of truth, and just share it with those who have yet don't have that love of truth, are still bound by the matrix, trying to solve the problems of the matrix. It's just a matter of sharing that in love and in recognition of ultimate equality. Equality of reality is perfect. So, and yet the ETs came in here and they started telling lies about the situation, that, oh no, the white men are only here to suppress everybody and enslave everybody, which is just a projection of what the ETs are really about. They're coming here to suppress and enslave. Totally, totally. For instance, I'm not here to suppress or enslave at all. I'm here to share love of truth with the world. The ETs are not here for that. They're coming here to suppress and enslave and set up their own dominance, and they want us to submit to them as superior. So they started telling all these lies. They told the lies to the feminine component of the world, saying that men only are trying to enslave you. They're trying to keep you in ignorance. And they said to the different races of the world, like the black race, saying, you're being completely exploited. They only want to keep you enslaved forever, which is totally untrue. And they said to, like, the gay culture, saying, they only have complete hatred for you, trying to suppress you, no, it's not true. It's not true. None of that is true. The ETs lied to all these different groups that need to cultivate their love of truth more and more and more, which we all do. They lied to them and told them that those who have the most authority in this world are only trying to enslave and exploit them, etc., which was a lie. And it's the ETs who are actually want to enslave and exploit them. So, but they have created through this propaganda this big lie. So what it's doing is nobody wants to believe those who do have a love of truth and have clarity. No one wants to believe them anymore. They say, oh no, you're only trying to enslave and exploit us, etc. So it's made the situation very difficult. But it's time to speak the truth, because the ETs will be coming out of the closet soon, and you have to. I know there's a ton of people in this world who know exactly what I'm talking about. It. Maybe half the world, really, if they listen. Because I remember what it was like before the ETs started really, really their propaganda campaign here. And people had much greater love and respect for one another in the past. Much greater. This notion that this world was some horrible place and it was only good for white males, it is not true at all. That is a big lie the ETs have told. Big lie. There was a lot of love and respect and understanding that you don't bring equality by lowering the bar. In other words, the world is a situation where we're trying to cultivate of truth. We're trying to accept reality as it is, and this is a tough path. And some have gone further than others. And those who have gone further lend a helping hand to the others. That is how it is. And you don't bring about a resolution but simply lowering the bar and saying, let's forget the goal, which is accepting reality as it is, and let's just throw that out. And then we'll just lower everything down to the lowest common denominator of just a human flesh, and make that the common denominator. And then who is more into the flesh? Who has more love of the flesh here? And then that tips things upside down. And so really what's happened is those who have the most love of the flesh in this world have now been lionized as superior. As superior, which makes it very easy for the ETs to take over this world. Because they can manipulate the flesh. They know how to do that. They're super good at that. But they cannot manipulate those who have love of truth and have clarified it. They cannot. Not so easily. It's very difficult for them. In fact, they're very afraid of that. So what they did was they took those who had a greater love of the flesh. And they deceived females to a large extent, because females have a natural maternal instinct. And they twisted this maternal instinct into kind of bamboobalizing. They twisted this into supposed love of the flesh, where it's not really. It is a maternal instinct of caring for children and those who need to be cared for. And they made it seem, it was very tricky what they did. But they sort of translate into that, that some extreme, all-important thing, ennobled it beyond what it really is, and said it's not being appreciated as this incredible thing that it is. So they overvalued it and misemphasized and got it all messed up, so that it seems like that women have been exploited throughout history because they're taking care of children, they weren't valued enough, etc., etc., etc. And they distorted the valuing. The whole system has gotten distorted, really. And they told lie after lie after lie after lie, just constant lies and distortions. And gradually we got used to those distortions. And the whole thing about child rearing, etc., has gotten completely distorted. The role of that particular role, the ETs have tried to put pigeonhole women into actually the role of the mother, and Christ saying, well, you can be the divine mother. And that is actually a terrible thing. So it is not good at all, because women have an equal ability to recognize, accept reality as it is, and get free of this matrix entirely, just the same as men. and realize that none of this was ever necessary. So, but when we build it up like the, oh, the Divine Mother, and having the maternal thing is like all important, that role of having children and raising children, taking care of them while they needed to be taken care of, etc., gets completely blown out of proportion. And then the idea of recognizing none of this was necessary in the first place becomes like you feel like you're losing all your value. So it's overemphasizing that role. We should neither overemphasize the male role or the female role. Of course, the male role is supposed to go out there and solve problems. You know, dig into the dirt, get all the minerals and natural resources, cut to build houses, build roads, bridges, etc., all this stuff. That too has been overvalued. I don't value either of those roles. I don't value the maternal divine mother role or the male solve all the problems role. Forget both of those. Neither of those are... should be overvalued. They're just pragmatic situations is all they are. But the ETs have instilled completely false value system in this world, and then said that we're not following this value system, so that makes us sexist or homophobic or racist or all these bigoted, intolerant, all this kind of stuff. It's all coming from the ETs and their own insecurities and their fear that we're not going to kowtow to them, which will freak them out. See, they don't take over a world unless the world will kowtow to them, because they're so insecure. They have such severe insecurities. Because they're ignorant. Because they know they haven't solved the problem of existence. Here they're coming as savior saying, we know how to solve your problems. And they know that they're rife with problems, that they're faced with just like impossible problems. And so they feel like phonies. They feel like frauds. So how does a fraud want people to respond to them? By kowtowing to them as a celebrity. And being dumbed down and accepting a distorted value system. So they don't want anyone here to ask them, say, wait a minute, what's going on? You don't seem to be, have you solved all the problems? What's really going on with you? And vetting them. They don't want to be vetted. They hate being vetted. ETs hate it. And they won't come into a world until people are willing to just submit to them without vetting them. Which, as we must point out, this current president was an exercise in refusing to vet a celebrity. He's really modeling a celebrity culture. He's more of a celebrity than a president, actually. And the whole program, the whole purpose of this was to not vet him, was to practice not vetting somebody who's actually not capable of doing the job, not really up to it at all. But we're supposed to see him as some super capable celebrity, incredibly smart, wise, almost like a divine being. That's all getting us ready for accepting the ETs here on this planet. Exactly what it is. And the media simply refused to vet it, because the whole media has to be on board with this ET thing. They have to refuse to vet the ETs. They just simply have to say, oh my gosh, they're here. And isn't this wonderful? And I get an interview, you know. One of these these media people will say, I have the first interview with the ETs. The ETs will be on Oprah. Maybe she'll reprise her show and say, I have the ETs. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm so glad you're here. Oh my God. Oh my God. It's so credible. Instead of vetting them, I mean, hey, let's ask some questions here, okay? Let's ask some questions. Like, why should we bow and submit to you? I mean, what's your opinion of Christ? What's your opinion of Nanda Mayama? What's your opinion of Ramana Maharshi? How do you fit in with what they've taught? You know, hey, vet them, right? No. So this president got a free ride by the media, and we all practice refusing to look into anything. Whereas those who did look into it, they're crazy, they're lunatics. Because there's a whole lot of stuff there to look into, which is super problematical, actually. And yet, those who look into it have been branded as lunatics, which is a practice for what's going to happen when the ETs come out of the closet. Anybody who looks into them, starts vetting them, will be seen as lunatics, fringe kooks. What do they call them? Wing nut jaw, wing nuts or something. I don't know what they say. What, wing nuts? What's a wing nut? I don't know. They will be demonized and marginalized and excluded from society. The media will just pay no attention, so they're complete lunatics. And all these people are saying, oh, wait a minute, who is this guy? You know, who is this president? Who is he? What's his background really? We don't know anything. Everything is shrouded and covered up and completely non-transparent. And the media doesn't have any interest in vetting it. What's going on here? How come we can't know the most important person on the face of this earth right now as far as power goes, and we don't know anything about it. Everything is secretive, and we only are supposed to believe what the media tells us to believe. We're not supposed to look into it. If we look into it, we're seen as kooks, that kind of thing. That's all preparing us for the extraterrestrials. That's exactly what it's for. Culture of the last 50 years has just been preparing us for the extraterrestrials. That's it. Or, if you were wise, you'd be preparing to sidestep the whole thing, which is what I have done, and which I know that many of you have actually been going in that direction too, and now it's just all coming out of the closet. The beans are being spilled, and you're seeing the context, and it takes a little while to adjust to this context, for sure. Because you're like, oh, you're not used to hearing anyone talk like this. Which is in a light-hearted way, because it is. I am light-hearted about it because it doesn't threaten me. I don't feel threatened by it. I don't feel bothered by it anymore. It's just obvious. It's transparent. Transparency is here. It is now here. This satsang is giving transparency, full transparency to the whole situation. We don't need to obsess about the president's past. I don't obsess about it. I've noticed the whole situation. I just kind of smile. It took me 15 minutes to see what he was all about. I had gave him 15 minutes of my attention, and I could read him like that. Saw his mind entirely, and that's it. I wouldn't say, okay, this is what's going on, and let's move on. Okay, but so I'm certainly aware of it. But we don't have to fixate on it. Don't fixate on that. That's at too low of a level. Bring your attention up to a higher level where you're lighthearted and you see all this and you realize I can accept reality as it is. I can accept reality as it is. There's nothing preventing me from accepting reality as it is because I'm already one with reality. I've always been one with reality. I've never left reality. I've never separated from it. I am simply dreaming of an imaginary problem that needs to be solved, and that problem will never arise. So I don't need to do anything. I need not do anything. I need not do anything to be what I am. To accept reality as it is. I'm already what I am in reality. I'm flawless. I'm perfect. I'm perfectly, seamlessly one with all of reality and will always be so. I don't need any learning for that to be true. I don't need to go through any evolution of consciousness for that to be true. I don't need to go through any learning of classrooms, struggling with crises, solving problems for that to be true. It's true right now. It's true right now, and it's true for everyone right now. It's true for all the ETs right now. It's true for all humanity right now. It's true for every aspect of spirit that has jumped into this hypothetical scenario. It's true for all of that, all of it, right now. And it's always been true and will always be true. So what's to worry about, really? Ultimately, there's nothing to worry about. Why was Ananda Mayama so completely blissful at all times? She knew there was nothing to worry about. She didn't have any concern. She knew everybody's already saved. It's a fait accompli, absolute fait accompli. It's just everything is just, it's like in a dream. Do you want to keep dreaming a little while longer? Do you want to wake up now? What you're dreaming about is completely inconsequential to reality. Totally inconsequential. She knew that perfectly well. So carefree and in bliss all the time. Completely carefree. And people say, how can you be carefree? I mean, all of Bengal is like starving to death. And she was completely carefree because she saw the big picture. That this is simply a dream. And real compassion is to radiate this bliss and carefreeness. That is true compassion, because that's what wakes us up from the dream. To be all over concerned and obsessed with the suffering of the world, that just seems to make the problem real, and which actually then delays the awakening. So it's better to be carefree and in bliss, completely blissed out. It is better. That's the highest type of witnessing in this world. And someday we'll all get there. It seems to be tough because people just look at you like, wow, you don't care about anybody, do you? And you have to really experience the situation truly for what it is to remain in this completely carefully blissed out situation. But I know that is possible here because it's been done. And it can be done again. If it's done once, it can be done again here. And hopefully we'll find someone who is completely blissed out and carefree. And that will help us greatly with this situation as the ETs come out of the closet, which is the big surprise that we have ahead for us in this world. As the Vatican says, get ready. What would happen if the ETs come out of the closet? How would you react to that? And their way, I mean, the homily that I heard and the encyclical, or whatever you call it, that I heard is, it's not profound. It's not profound. They don't have escape velocity, in other words, to it. They don't. They're kind of reaching and saying it was watered down too much. It really was. I appreciate the effort. and the thought, and just appreciate doing that, that they did that. But we need to be much more explicit about it and much more on point about it, which we're doing here. But no disrespect to them saying that. That is a step in the right direction. But we need to take many more steps, more adamant steps in that direction to be ready for this time, which could come very soon, actually. It could come within a matter of weeks or days or months. It could come very soon. The world has been primed for this. Very much primed. You have these Comic-Con conventions where everybody goes, they dress up as extraterrestrials. I mean, there's the younger generation is they've grown up on watching cartoons of ETs. They're ready for it. And of course, they feel that the older generation is holding them back because we're willing to bow to these ETs and appreciate how great they are, etc. No, the older generation knows that the ETs, they have this feeling, a correct feeling, the ETs are actually inferior, and they've done a con job on the world. They've done a con job on the world. And they exploited, they gave these people who needed to work on their clarification, they gave them a false shortcut. They said, hey, I can give you a shortcut. These people that are trying to help you now, they're actually holding you back. They're suppressing you, which is not true. And we can give you a shortcut. We can elevate you up to equal status. Boom, like that. Just help us come into this world and we'll set everything straight. That is the big lie, the big con that the ETs have done. They're con artists. And their con has been seen through. Their con has been seen through here, for sure. And I know many are in the process or have seen through this con, or they're sorting it out. And I'm just helping tell you, yes, you can sort it out, and it's okay, absolutely okay. Do not be frightened or afraid of that, doing that. You don't stand alone. You don't stand alone. There's still tremendous will on this planet realizing, hey, we've been conned. This planet has been conned by the extraterrestrials, totally conned. And big lies have been told here. And all this stuff about getting modeling to get ready, all this prep for the advent of the ETs here, which, as I said, this present number 44, that's what it's all been about, is prepping for these ETs. He has been trying to model what it's like, accepting rulership. Expect to be dominated by someone that you really don't want to be dominated by. You know, there's really no reason we should be dominated by this president and look up to him as some superstar at all. And yet we're being told that if we don't, we're racist. We have all these ill-founded reasons not to submit to the awesome intelligence and problem-solving abilities, you know. I mean, to say, well, wait a minute. You gotta be joking. You must be joking. It's not a joke. They're trying to get us ready for the ETs, who themselves are a joke. They're a joke. ETs are a joke. They're like idiot savants. Really, do we really want to be governed by idiot savants? That's what they are. They're idiot savants. And of course, in living here in Silicon Valley, there's all these head honchos of these big high-tech companies that we're all kowtowing to because they're, you know, incredibly wealthy, and we think, oh my God, they're so smart. No, they're idiot savants too. They're idiot savants. They need to sit quietly in satsang and recognize that they're miserable and that they're idiot savants and they don't know the answer. And they should listen to who does. Instead, the ETs are just saying, no, let's get rid of all the wisdom of this world, the authority of this world, which came from those who have worked hard to clarify. A lot of the respect and authority of this world came from those who have worked really hard here to clarify. And the ETs now want to demonize that and claim that was nothing but suppression, and now they're here to save us all, make everybody happy. What a big lie that is. What a con job that is. What a miserable situation that is the world is going into. All the while the ETs say they're leading us into a golden age. Are you kidding? Are you kidding? At the expense of throwing out any all and any wisdom about what true salvation really is, which is accepting reality as it is, instead of working on this crazy hypothetical scenario of trying to solve problems and fix problems and meet crises and meet challenges, etc., none of which are real. None of which are real. So they want us to deny the great teachers that have been here, to make it seem like all this cause was racism and sexism and homophobia and all these bigotry, etc. That's all that it gave rise to, which is a total distortion. total distortion. Of course there have been problems. It's not been a smooth road. The whole thing is not a smooth road. Absolutely not. But again, we have to put up with the bumpy road to get to where we're going. And the ETs have said, hey, take this paved road. But this paved road, what does it lead to? Enslavement. Enslavement here. Super inequality here. Super dominance here. You talk about inequality, that's what they bring. You talk about enslavement, that's what they bring. You talk about keeping people in ignorance and exploiting them, that's what they bring. All under the guise of equality. What it is, equality of stupid, it's stupidity. They want everybody to be equally stupid, and them ruling over us is what they want. It's a kind of like saying, well, cows are all equal. Yeah, because they're all stupid, equally stupid compared to us. And so, of course, we know how to rule over cattle. That's what the ETs want us. They want us to all be cattle. They want us to all be sheeple. They want us to be sheeple. And they've been preparing us for that and trying to demonize those who don't want to go along with that as you know, these just horrible, you know, every name in the book they throw. Every name in the book. None of it sticks. None of it sticks. It's just simply they think they're finding a shortcut to salvation. And it's not. They're simply falling back into delusion and regressing. They're saying, wow, the way that they've been shot told to us is too difficult. It's too difficult. Well, because a lot of it was distorted. So, of course, it seems more difficult than it really is. So, what is the answer? If the spiritual teachings have been distorted, what's the answer? Clarify them. Re-clarify them. Don't throw them out. Don't say, let's get rid of all of them. It's too tough. It's been too tough because it was distorted. Teachings of Christ were distorted. So, of course, that makes it feel futile. And people say, I'm not getting anywhere. It's too difficult. Well, what's the answer? Say it's all a myth, say it's all a lie, and just get rid of all of it? Or say, no, wait a minute. There is truth to it, but it got distorted, so let's reaffirm the truth. The answer to the problems of the world is to reaffirm the truth, not to invite the ETs in here and to get rid of all truth here. That's not the answer. That's a trap. That's a con job by the ETs. The answer is reaffirm the truth, re-clarify it, and say, hey, of course we got off track a little bit. That's par for the course. Maybe it's a bogey. We made a bogey. Maybe we made a double bogey. What do? Do you quit the game? When you make a double bogey on the first hole, do you throw your clubs in the lake and go home in a pout and a snit? Now you say, wow, what's wrong with my swing? And you ask a friend. Maybe you have a friend who's a golf pro. You say, hey, pro. What am I doing? I'm doing something wrong. The pro says, yeah, your rhythm is you're getting your body out in front of the swing. You're holding your backswing. You're holding it too long to try to get more power, and you're getting your body out in front, and that way you're pushing it and you're shooting it over in the lake. You're trying to overpower the ball, in other words. And you say, okay. And then you listen to that, and you realize when you take slow, and then at the top, you've got to make a quick transition like that. Boom! You suddenly start hitting it great. And you say, whoa, I hit it as good as the pro did. That's awesome. That's how you do it. You don't throw your clubs in the lake and go home. So you take a double bogey, triple bogey on the first hole. You mess it up. You say, okay, I need to get better. And you don't curse the game. Say, this is terrible. I hate this. Say, wow, okay, I need to get better. And it's probably just a little thing. The pro will just fix your swing like that, and you say, okay, I see now I'm doing. That's all it is. That's all it is here. We need to reaffirm the truth, recognize that we got a little bit off track because the matrix distorted it, belief distorted it, it intimidated us, it bullied us, it threatened us. You see, we got off track because we got threatened. The belief threatens us. We have to realize that when we start to go towards salvation, accepting reality as it is, belief will tries to try to intimidate us and terrorize us and threaten us and make us fear, I'm going to be annihilated, I'm going to be excluded, all this stuff. And that knocks us off track. And then we adopt a hybrid version of truth, which is not truth at all. When you say that there's some part of truth that's a lie or some part of a lie that's truth, that's a complete lie. There's not half-truths or total lies. Truth is never halfway. There's no such thing as a half-truth in truth. So to say there's a half-truth is 100% a lie. And so these things need to be reaffirmed. What A Course in Miracles did was just reaffirm the truth and got us back on track. That's all. That's all we need to do. We don't just give up and say, let's take the ET shortcut. And let's just throw away truth altogether and make the kingdom of the flesh. Make that, and that seems easier to us. We're used to that. Huge mistake. Huge mistake. And really, a lot of the world doesn't really want that. At least a lot of the people in the United States don't want that. Seems like the rest of the world does want it to a large extent. But there's a lot of people in the United States to say, no. Because the United States really was the most advanced country in the world. And people all over the world who wanted freedom came here. Because they sense there's an opportunity here. It's an opportunity for some kind of freedom. And we're not quite sure what. But it's an opportunity to speak our minds, to not be intimidated by any dogma. To figure it out for ourselves. The freedom to look for ourselves and see, instead of having some institution dogmatizing us and then severe reprisals if we don't go along with that. Whatever it is, we felt like, hey, I can move out in the prairie. I can move out in the woods. I can move. I can contemplate the truth. And this probably brings this video to an end. So blessings to you, and we will keep going strong. All right, very great.